Good morning, dear students. Very good morning. Today we are going to do lesson 5, Snapshots, Mother's Day. As the title suggests, we are going to discuss about the significance of the love of the mothers that we receive every day, every moment. If you see, this lesson is a play. Plays are meant for stages and you know, theaters and all. But as a textual literary piece, it is to read and cherish, right? So, we are going to start this lesson, which is of course a humorous portrayal. But along with that humor, there is infusing of, or there is an infused seriousness in the message. Mother's Day. The following play is a humorous portrayal of the status of the mother in a family. Let's read on to see how Mrs. Pearson's family reacts when she tries to stand up for her own rights. Right? You can open page number 32, Snapshots. Okay? I hope my voice is clear. I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Let's read. You may open your books. Page number 32. Okay? Let me share the screen also. Yes. Now, let's see. The following play is a humorous portrayal. As I said, of the status of the women, of the mother in a family. And this is characters, Mrs. Annie Pearson, her husband George Pearson, right? Doris and Cyril, their children, and Mrs. Fitzgerald. The action takes place in the living room of the Pearson's house in a London suburb, right? And this is the setting for the, you know, stage or where the action takes place. The living room of Pearson family afternoon. It is a comfortably furnished, much lived in room in a small suburban semi-detached villa. If necessary, only one door need to be used, but it is better with two, one up left leading to the front door and the stairs, and the other in the right wall leading to the kitchen and the back door. If you suppose stage this play in some school occasion or some program in school, celebrating Mother's Day in school and presenting this play. So these are all the settings that can be used. Okay, and how the first scene or the act starts, right? So the furniture description is there. There is a settee up right, an armchair down left, and one down, a small table with two chairs on either side of it stands at the center, right? So, and when the curtain rises, it is an afternoon in early autumn and the stage can be well lit. Mrs. Pearson at right and Mrs. Fitzgerald at left are sitting opposite each other at the small table on which are two teacups and saucers and the cards with which Mrs. Fitzgerald has been telling Mrs. Pearson's fortune. The next character that has been discussed, we discussed these four characters, we shared Mrs. Annie Pearson, George Pearson, Doris Pearson, Cyril Pearson, and Mrs. Fitzgerald, who's friend of Mrs. Pearson, right? So they both are sitting and talking, right? When the curtain rises, it is an afternoon in early autumn and the stage can be well lit. Mrs. Pearson at right and Mrs. Fitzgerald at left are sitting opposite each other at the small table on which are two teacups and saucers and the cards with which Mrs. Fitzgerald has been telling Mrs. Pearson's fortune. So this line, you can underline Mrs. Fitzgerald's one characteristic we have received, that she used to tell fortune. Fortune teller, friend of Mrs. Pearson. Mrs. Pearson is the mother about whom we talked in the introduction. We discussed in the introduction that how she stands up, how she tries up against the odds or whatever happens in the play. Mrs. Pearson is a pleasant but worried looking woman in her 40s. Mrs. Fitzgerald is older, heavier, and a strong and sinister personality. Right? She's more bolder than Mrs. Pearson. She's smoking. It is very important that these two should have sharply contrasting voices. If we select two characters even from our class, so two different characters, one with little timid voice, one with strong voice. Mrs. Pearson speaking in a light, florid sort of tone with a touch of suburban Cockney perhaps, and Mrs. Fitzgerald with a deep voice, rather Irish perhaps. So this is the description, and here we begin with the dialogues, right? And you can see the pic in your book as well as on the screen also. Okay, Mrs. Fitzgerald collecting the cards, and that's all I can tell you. Mrs. Pearson could be a good fortune, could be a bad one. All depends on yourself now. Make up your mind and there it is. Yes, thank you, Mrs. Fitzgerald. I'm much obliged, I'm sure. It's wonderful having real fortune teller living next door. Did you learn that out east too? So they are just conversing that it is up to you, you try. Now, what is that trial she's talking about? What is she talking about? I did 12 years I had of it with my old man rising to be lieutenant quartermaster. He learnt a lot and I learnt a lot more. But will you make up your mind now? Now she's insisting on something. Have you made up your mind? Will you make up your mind, Mrs. Pearson dear? Put your foot down once and for all and be the mistress of your own house and the boss of your own family. So that means she has not been enjoying the rights a mother should have, the respect that a mother should have. And she's guiding her that keep your foot down and be the mother-like figure in your house. Don't be submissive, extraordinarily obedient before your husband and kids, and they keep on disregarding you. Dear students, you might have seen many houses, children do not regard their parents, they do not regard their elders. They take the things granted. If they are guided about some things, they say, you don't know. Right? Maybe we do not fall in that category, but there are. So this is the story of course, Mrs. Pearson on the at the center as a motherly figure, as a mother, and Mrs. Fitzgerald, her friend, but discussing about the entire family. And let me tell you, characteristics of drama, there is very important thing close to life is dialogues. If you read a play, if you enact a play, you go through the script and all, you see dialogues. The most important thing, how you imbibe that is dialogues. So here we are moving on with these, through these dialogues, and smiling apologetically. That's easier said than done. She says it is easy to say. Besides, I'm so fond of them. Even if they are so thoughtless and selfish, they don't mean to be. They are so thoughtless, they don't realize. What they don't realize, that the mother is working hard all day. But they take it so granted, right? So this way, the mother here is not a happy mother. And the reason for her unhappiness is her children's disregard. Even by husband, she's not being taken care of that way as he should. He's also thoughtless and careless. She's working hard in and out on all days, right? So, Mrs. Fitzgerald, her friend, who is a fortune teller, they're having a cup of coffee or tea on a tea table, coffee table at home, and they're discussing these things, and she's suggesting, now you must raise your voice. But it would be better for them if they learned that to treat you properly. So another point you've got, that they do not treat their mother properly. Yes, I suppose it would in a way. No doubt about it at all. You do what I'm saying and there's no doubt. Who's the better? Who's the better for being spoiled? Grown man, lad or the girl? Mrs. Fitzgerald asks, who is the spoiled one? Your husband or the boy, the lad or the girl? Nobody. You think it does them good when you run after them all the time, take their orders as if you were the servant in the house, stay at home every night while they go out enjoying themselves? never in all your life. It's the ruin of them as well as you. Husbands, sons, daughters should be taking notice of wives and mothers not giving them orders and treating them like dirt. And don't tell me you don't know what I mean, for I know more than you have told me. Right? So, Mrs. Pearson, keep dropping a hint. Hint, it's more than hints your family needs. She says, I do. I keep giving them hints. In a low voice, she says, I know what hints you might be giving. You're so timid and mild, nobody is going to listen to you. It's more than hints your family needs, Mrs. Pearson. Now, she suggests that your family doesn't need now hints. They need a nice lesson. I suppose it is, but I do hate any unpleasantness in my family. And it is so hard to know where to start. I keep making up my mind to have it out with them somehow, but I don't know how to begin. And she glances at a watch or at a clock. Oh, good gracious, look at the time. Nothing ready. They'll be home any minute and probably all in a hurry to go out again. Oh, I've not cooked anything. I've not done anything. They'll be back. And then again to go in the evening classes, sessions, club, whatever they'll wish to. Right? So she's worried. And Mrs. Fitzgerald reaches out across the table and pulls her down. Sit down. Let them wait or look after themselves for once. This is where your foot goes down. Start now. And she lights a cigarette from the one she has just finished. Mrs. Pearson. Mrs. Fitzgerald, I know you mean well, in fact. I agree with you, but I just can't. You cannot make all of a sudden a timid person, a mild person, a very soft-spoken person, a very rude and harsh and all. So Mrs. Fitzgerald is telling her, guiding her, suggesting her, be strict, be stern. If you'll take yourself granted, then others will definitely take you granted and treat you like that. I agree with you, but I just can't. She expresses her ability to do that, what the stronger lady, the strict lady is telling her to do with her children and the husband. And it's no use you trying to make me. If I promise you, I would really have it out with them. I know I wouldn't be able to keep my promise. If I promise you, Mrs. Fitzgerald, I won't be able to keep that promise that yes, I'll do, but I won't be able to do that. Then let me do it. How will you do? So there is impersonation, dramas, plays, representation through dialogues, imitation, impersonation, right? You might have seen on the school stage also when there is a play, English play, Hindi play, suppose a character is there of some mother, some father, any other role, you see they impersonate them, not only the costumes but the dialogues. If a role is being played of a doctor, the small child of class 9th or 10th or whatever class he is, he impersonates all the skills that doctor possesses. Yes, keep your audios off, bitter, and videos on, right? So, this much is clear, dear students. This much is clear. Very good. Yes, be prompt and crisp in your virtual responses, verbal responses, so that we can move further. Yes, now, you haven't got the idea. Now she thinks, so she says, then let me do it for you. Okay, I'm sorry, I thought you asked me to let you do it. I did, but not as me, as you. Now there's impersonation. Mrs. Fitzgerald, let me tell you, let me give you the clue. Mrs. Fitzgerald will become Mrs. Pearson and Mrs. Pearson will become Mrs. Fitzgerald. So impersonation, acting as the other person, right? But here she'll do magic. She knows some magical spell to change the personalities. This Mrs. Fitzgerald is not only a fortune teller, but she knows this also, right? So let us move to this part of the dialogues. You haven't got the idea. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you asked me to let you do it. I did, but not as me. I'll not do all these things and teach your children a lesson as Mrs. Fitzgerald. That I cannot, but I will become Mrs. Pearson. As you can underline, dear children, the lines in your book, but I don't understand. You couldn't be me. So she says that, how come you will become me? We'll change places or really bodies. You look like me, I look like you. But that is impossible. How do you know? Ever tried it? Have you ever tried this? How that this is impossible? No, of course not. I have. Not for some time, but it still ought to work. Won't last long, but long enough for what we want to do. Not for months or like that, few hours. You will become me and I'll change myself like you. So impersonate. I will impersonate you. Not only imitate the way you speak, but I know how to look like you and you will look like me. And she said, oh really, we change places. We'll change bodies. Won't last long, but long enough for what we want to do with your children and family. Learned it out east, of course, where they are up to all these tricks. She holds her hand out across the table, keeping the cigarette in her mouth. Give me your hands, dear. Now give me your hands. Well, I don't know. Is it right? Now Mrs. Pearson is confused. She's saying, is it right that I give my hands and we do this and like, give me your hands? And she starts that magic. It's your only chance that you have to teach them a good lesson. Give me your hands and keep quiet a minute. Just don't think about anything. And she took her hands. Now look at me. And they stare at each other, muttering. She's saying something, Arshatta Dam and all like that. Lam Dam Buna. And their bodies are exchanged. The little scene should be done very carefully on the stage. We are to assume that the personalities are changing bodies. Personalities change bodies. After the spell has been spoken, both women, still grasping hands, go lax, go relieved, as if the life were out of them. They then both came to life. After a few seconds, a minute or two, they both are again back to life with the personality of each other. So each must try to adopt the voice and mannerisms of the other. So now Mrs. Pearson is bold and dominating, and Mrs. Fitzgerald is nervous and fluttering. So they have changed their bodies, they have changed their things, but now Mrs. Pearson, who was timid, actually the inside is Mrs. Fitzgerald, and Mrs. Fitzgerald, who was quite dominating, is now Mrs. Pearson. Mrs. Pearson now with Mrs. Fitzgerald personality. See what I mean, dear? She notices the cigarette. Here you don't want that. She snatches it and puts it in her own mouth, puffing contentedly. Right? Mrs. Fitzgerald now with Mrs. Pearson's personality looks down at herself and sees that the body has changed and gives a scream of fright. Now, dear children, this part, you can see the screen, their bodies are changed. So Mrs. Fitzgerald is actually with Mrs. Pearson's personality. You can even write with the pencil. If it is Mrs. Fitzgerald, this is actually Mrs. Pearson. Oh, it has happened. It has happened. Right? Of course it has happened. Very neat. Didn't know I had it in me. Right? But whatever shall I do? Mrs. Fitzgerald, George and the children can't see me like this. So if you see Mrs. Fitzgerald, wherever there is mentioned Mrs. Fitzgerald in capital, it is Mrs. Pearson in this part of the lesson, because they are changed personalities. They have changed themselves. Right? Okay. So of course it has happened. Very neat. Didn't know I had it in me. But whatever shall I do, Mrs. Fitzgerald? So Mrs. Fitzgerald telling to Mrs. Fitzgerald, no. It is Mrs. Pearson telling to Mrs. Fitzgerald, George and the children can't see me like this. They're going to. That's the point. They will have to. They'll have me to deal with only. They won't know it. Mrs. Fitzgerald is still alarmed. Now she's not Mrs. Fitzgerald. Again, you have to remind all the time when you are reading the dialogues here. Now, but what if we can't change back? It would be terrible, right? Now she says, if this happens that we are not able to change ourselves, then yes, but I don't want to be anybody else. Now stop worrying. It is easier changing back. I can do it any time we want. Don't worry, I'll do it. Well, do it now. She says, no, no, you tell me how you do it. Not likely. I've got the deal. I have got to deal with your family first. That's the idea, isn't it? Didn't know how to begin with them. You said, well, I'll show you. But what am I going to do? Go into my house for a bit? So Mrs. Pearson says, if you are Mrs. Pearson now, then what will I do here? Go to my house, enjoy there, there's nobody there. Then pop back and see how we are doing. You ought to enjoy it. Better get off now before one of them comes. Now nervously rising, now Mrs. Fitzgerald rising. She's Mrs. Pearson rising nervously. Yes, I suppose that's the best. You're sure it will be all right. It would be wonderful. Now off you, go dear. She orders her, go dear. And she chuckles, right? And then Mrs. Fitzgerald crosses and hurries out through the door, right? Left to herself, Mrs. Pearson smokes away, lighting another cigarette and begins laying out the cards for patience on table. After a few moments, Doris Pearson comes bursting in left. She is a pretty girl in her early 20s who would be pleasant enough if she had not been spoiled. She was a pleasant girl, right, in early 20s. And if she had not been spoiled, she would have been a wonderful girl, right? So this way, we have covered up the introduction as well as the dialogues in the beginning and the changing of the bodies of Mrs. Fitzgerald, not only bodies, but the personalities and the cults and the trends. And now for a few hours, say for 3 to 4 hours, or a couple of hours, Mrs. Fitzgerald is going to teach them a lesson, and you know, a nice lesson by being impersonating as Mrs. Pearson. I hope you have understood this much of part. Now let's see the character of Doris, right? Before she has taken anything in, Mum, you'll have to iron my yellow silk. I must wear it tonight, right? So she's ordering her mother, you'll have to, what are you doing? Mrs. Pearson now uses her ordinary voice, but her manner is not fluttering and apologetic, but cool and incisive, right? She's very crisp now, very cool, but like she's, it can be felt that she's rude, right? Very blatant. Mrs. Pearson, not even looking up. Now, this is not Mrs. Pearson, but Mrs. Fitzgerald as Mrs. Pearson. She doesn't look up also what the daughter is saying. What do you think I'm doing? Whitewashing the ceiling? What are you doing? So she said, what do you think I'm whitewashing the ceiling? Real Mrs. Pearson would have never answered her daughter like this, right? Doris, but you are smoking. That's right, dear. No law against it, is there? But I thought you didn't smoke. Then you thought whatever you thought was wrong. Then you thought wrong. Are we having tea in the kitchen? Have it where you like, dear. Do you mean it isn't ready? So she's expecting that the mother should keep the tea ready, right? Mrs. Pearson, yours isn't. I have had all I want. Mine I had, yours is not. Might go out later and get a square meal at the Clarendon, right? So who might? Now Doris says, hardly believing her ears. I might, who do you think? Mum, what's the matter with you? So the mother has started all of a sudden behaving very differently, right? Don't be silly. It's not me that's being silly. And I must say, it's a bit much when I have been working hard all day and you can't even bother to get my tea ready. Did you hear what I said about my yellow silk? No. Don't you like it now? I never did. Of course I like it, and I'm going to wear it tonight. And so I want it ironed. Want it ironed? What do you think it's going to do, iron itself? No, you are going to iron it for me. You always do. Well, this time I will not. I don't. And don't talk rubbish to me about working hard. I have a good idea how much you do, Doris Pearson. I put in twice the hours you do and get no wages, nor thanks for it. Why are you going to wear your yellow silk? Where are you going? Right? She says, out with Charlie Spence. Why? And why? Why? What is the matter with you? Why shouldn't I go out with Charlie Spence if he asks me? And I want to. Any objections? Go on, you might as well tell me. Can't you find anybody better? I wouldn't be seen dead with Charlie Spence. Right? Buck teeth and half witted. So even she curses her daughter. Now this is not Mrs. Pearson, but Mrs. Fitzgerald. And these dialogues have brought very closer to the character sketch of Doris Pearson. Right? Dear students, we'll continue the class tomorrow, this Mother's Day play from Snapshots. Right? Okay? So we'll be continuing it tomorrow. Stay safe, stay healthy, right? Okay? Thank you.